My name is Dimitra Vajina, and I will be talking today about John Locke's and John Rawls' social contract theories, about the state of nature, the original position, and the veil of ignorance. Most of the theories that stem from the philosophy of natural law and aim to explain how political societies are built are based on the idea of the social contract. Such political theories consist of two main elements: the contract, which defines how a governed society is established, and the state of nature, which explains how people lived before political societies when they all were born equal and free. Although social contract theories, such as Locke and Rawls, use different arguments regarding both the natural state and the terms of the agreement, they all build their theories on the same idea in order to explain the transition from the state of nature to political society. They refer to a contract between equal parts who consciously agree on establishing a legitimate society under certain conditions. Thus, the aim of social contract theories is to explain how, and most importantly, why, people went from being free and equal to being governed. The main argument of the critique regarding social contract theories is that they cannot be convincing enough because what they describe does not really exist. How can we base an entire political theory on an imaginary natural state that we have no historical indication that existed and on a contract that has never been signed? Indeed, social contract theories are completely hypothetical and historically untenable. Nevertheless, we are not addressing historical theories. Social contract theories are analytical and aim to demonstrate that before the birth of political societies, human beings were all born equal to the natural law. This is the main point on which all social contract theorists base their arguments on. According to Will Kimlicka, the idea of state of nature does not represent an anthropological claim about the pre-social existence of human beings, but a moral claim about the absence of natural subordination amongst human beings. Both Locke and Rawls refer to the idea of the social contract and the way they apply it. Indicatively, Locke claims that we cannot argue that there has never been a state of nature just because we cannot find written evidence of it. For political societies are just like human beings. They remember nothing of their infancy and childhood. Everything they may know regarding their origins results randomly from other people's written monuments. John Rawls often refers to the contract as hypothetical. Now let's see what Locke says about the social contract theories. What Locke aims to explain is how morally equal human beings remain so, even though at some point they decide to choose who will govern them, yet preserving political equality. He describes the state of nature as a peaceful state of freedom and equality, where no human being depends on another's will and no one has power over another. Even though it's a state of liberty, it's not a state of impunity. With Locke's own words, man has not liberty to destroy himself, or so much as any creature in his possession, but where some nobler use and its spare preservation calls for it. Therefore, human beings cannot violate the law of nature. Human life must be preserved. And that's why reason, which is identified with the natural law, rules the state of nature and makes human beings act morally by defining that someone cannot harm one's life, health, freedom, or possessions. Thus, three fundamental natural rights exist: the right to life, the right to liberty, and the right to private property. According to Locke's theory, property is a natural, pre-political right that does not only mean private property, but also property in oneself. As he quotes, "By property, I must be understood to mean that property which men have in their persons as well as goods." Property in one's person has a double meaning. Firstly, it means material substance. Therefore, if someone harms a person's physical self, they also harm his or her property in his or her material substance. Consequently, preservation of human life stems from protecting property in person. Furthermore, property in one's person means property in one's personality as well, which means free will cannot be violated. Hence, both the right to life and that to liberty derive from the right to property. And in addition, since people own themselves, they also own their labor. labor turns any common good that it's mixed with it into private property. Therefore, property is the key term of John Locke's social contract theory. The purpose of the transition from the state of nature to political society is to protect life, liberty, and private property. It tests property in all its three meanings. Consequently, the natural law gives human beings three authorities. First, they have the authority to destroy any person who threatens their existence. Second, they can do what they desire in order to preserve themselves and others. And third, people have the authority to punish whoever objects to the law of nature. There comes a time when people choose some of them to give those authorities up on. In return, the chosen ones, the governance, will have to protect the natural law, using these authorities in the interest of people. If at some point the governance misuse their power, the contract will be broken. This agreement is Locke's contract, his trust, as he names it. This is how he seals his social contract theory, demonstrating how the transition from the state of nature to political societies does not bring any moral inequality, since the contract is signed freely and consciously by both parts and can be broken anytime that people feel the government is not protecting their natural rights. Sorry. So let's go to Rawls' theory. In his theory of justice, where John Rawls describes his social contract theory, he claims that his aim is to present a conception of justice which generalizes and carries to a higher level of abstractions the familiar theory of the social contract as found, say, in Locke. Rawls' aim is to describe a situation of agreement that is fair among all the parties forming a social contract based on the two fundamental principles of justice as fairness: liberty and equality. The main purpose of this contractual construction is to create principles as a rule that will govern any further agreement, thus defining, in addition to the basic social institutions, the possible types both of political cooperation and of political governance. Rawls' corresponding term to Locke's state of nature is the original position. Human beings in the original positions are free and equal, just like in Locke's state of nature, but also have a conception of the rational good and a sense of justice. Rawls believes that the state of nature is not an initial position of equality, and that is because some people have more bargaining power than others, and so they tend to agree on terms that benefit their interests. Therefore, Rawls wants his original position to represent equality between human beings as moral persons who come to an agreement as equals when none are known to be advantaged by social and natural contingencies. He describes the original position as an expository device which sums up the meaning of our notions of fairness and helps us to extract their consequences. To do so, he needs something more to enhance moral equality, something that will prevent people from knowing and using their advantages when forming the social contract. So, he adds to his original position one device that will help him eliminate all inequalities: the veil of ignorance. People in the original position are behind a veil of ignorance so that, as Rawls states, no one knows his place in society, his class position or social status, nor does anyone know his fortune in the distribution of natural assets and abilities, his intelligence, strength, and the like. I, Rawls, shall even assume that the parties do not know their conception of the good or their special psychological propensities. Furthermore, they know nothing about their generation or the social circumstances of their era. Hence, they know nothing that would let them choose the contract's principles in favor of their interests. Yet, they have some general information about human societies, such as information on how social organization works and the fundamental laws of human psychology. They are also aware that there are some goods, the primary goods, that they cannot go without in order to live a worthwhile life. All that the parts of the contract are kept from knowing behind the veil of ignorance, and all that they know result in making them as fair as they should be in order to choose the fairest principles possible, forming this way a contract that can apply to any fair agreement or bargain. To sum up, though both Locke and Rawls are liberal social contract theories who aim to promote liberty and equality, They base their theories on totally different grounds. While Locke legitimizes the transition from the state of nature to political societies through property, Rawls builds on the idea of justice. He describes the perfect conditions in order to reach the point where the parts of the contract cannot but to choose to base the agreement on liberty and equality, the two principles of justice as fairness that, from a fair contract, eliminate all inequalities. In this way, Rawls takes political liberalism to a whole new level, that of egalitarianism. Thank you very much for hearing all this.